Thanks, Joe. As Joe says, we're going to touch on a subject that was introduced this morning, both with the first panel and the former Deputy Attorney General, and that is criminal discovery and how we're living in a sea of data and how to deal with that. And I'm very pleased to have with us today on my far right, Erin Taylor, who is an assistant federal public defender and trial team leader in the Western District of North Carolina. She has a rare and special talent for being a terrific jury lawyer and also a techie and a fan of technology. And there's a lot that she can teach us that will help us represent our clients and do justice. Next to her is Claire Rauscher. She's a partner at the Womble Bond Dickinson Law Firm. She's a fellow of the American College of Trial Lawyers. She's one of the nation's leading advocates for defendants' rights. She has a wealth of experience that is also relevant to this. Finally, Charlie Peeler, to my immediate right, is the former U.S. Attorney for the Middle District of Georgia. He's at Troutman Sanders now. He's litigated and tried many civil and criminal cases, which gives him an excellent perspective on how civil discovery compares to criminal discovery, and it's my belief that we criminal litigators are behind our brothers and sisters who litigate civil cases in terms of technology. He's also the only former prosecutor on this panel. We've got three lifelong, career-long defense lawyers, and so he will be taking the prosecutor's perspective from time to time, and the three of us will try not to pick on you too much, Charlie.
I should have positioned myself on the end where I could run if I needed to.
So I want to start by pitching just a little bit the new discovery standards from the criminal justice system, the ABA, which were published in 2020. And I had the privilege of being on the advisory group for that, and we spent many weekends together talking about what should be in them. For the most part, it was prosecutors, academics, judges, and defense lawyers. For the most part, we were able to come to agreement. One of the most controversial things, and this is within the last 5 years, is whether there should be a section or provisions addressing electronic discovery. And everybody on that advisory group was of a certain age, and there was a considerable number of people who said we shouldn't talk about e-discovery. It only comes up rarely in cases. It's a very specialized thing. And eventually the decision was made to include it. It basically incorporated a joint protocol worked out between the Justice Department and the Federal Defenders, National Federal Defenders Office, on sort of some guidelines about how to pursue electronic discovery. But it found its way into a section called Special Proceedings, as if it's a rare and special thing. And I'd like to begin the panel today by asking people in sort of a lightning round, is electronic discovery rare and special in your experience? And how has the pandemic affected the transcendence of electronic discovery? Charlie?
I don't think it's as rare as someone having a cell phone. I'll put it like that. No, I think virtually every case from my time in the U.S. Attorney's Office, and I'll start with that, it doesn't matter if it's a gun and drug case or a fraud case or a child case or whatever it is, there's going to be electronic discovery, even if it's just the camera footage from the officer's body-worn camera, you know, at a takedown. And so it's not going away. One thing that I think is that prosecutors and defense lawyers have a common hatred in part of it just because of the sheer volume and then how to figure out how to deal with that volume. But no, in my view, it's in every case. It's been, Rob's point, it's been in every civil case for a long time now, and I think it's there in criminal cases and only going to increase in volume.
Claire?
Yeah, I was just trying to think, when was the last time I had a case that didn't have electronic discovery? And I think it was back in 2005 when I started as the federal defender in the Western District of North Carolina. I think that was sort of the end because I remember we started a paperless office at the time. And I remember saying, we're going to have to do this because it's starting to trickle in. But I can't think of a case right now. I have so many cases that have nothing but electronic discovery. There's no hard copies. There's nothing, there's none of that paper stuff anymore.
Erin?
Yeah, I'm so thankful to Clear for starting the office in a paperless environment, because we were incredibly prepared years ago to handle the situation. But I don't remember the last time I even received a piece of paper or held a piece of paper other than my own notepad. I think the pandemic has forced a lot of attorneys who are so accustomed to the older way of doing things to kind of shift and become more proficient in handling electronic discovery. And I think it's made all of us better attorneys as a result, and more flexible. And so I'm looking forward to seeing where things go.
So I want to start on sort of a specific topic, and that is that relates to the proliferation of electronic data that we have, and that is taint teams. And when I started, or also known as filter teams, and when I started about 30 years ago, first of all, search warrants were fairly rare in white-collar criminal cases. And second of all, the way they were normally executed is the FBI would show up with a list of what they could take and what they couldn't, and they were supposed to look at file folders, and they were supposed to take some, carefully select, what, at least in theory, what they could take and what they couldn't take. And now what happens is a special team of computer technicians shows up from the FBI, and they image an entire server or multiple servers. And my question, I'm going to start with you, Charlie, is our designated G person today, to explain from the government's perspective, at least while you were a U.S. attorney and sort of the normal practice that may be changing a little bit that Claire can tell us about, how does the government deal with the issue that they're taking off an entire an electronic warehouse of documents on a server that may have many things that are irrelevant to the case and may have privileged information in it as well?
Yeah, it's difficult. I think that the department is moving slowly but in the right direction by training more and more people at the district level how to deal with electronic discovery. There is there's a discovery center in South Carolina that can process a lot of electronic discovery, and they do, lots and lots of work. But what my experience was is that, it often slowed cases down to have to ship to everything to South Carolina to be processed. And what we needed was more people on the ground in the district who can do it. And so resources were made available. I think that's going to continue, and it has to continue. On the filter team side of things, there's some tricky case law out there now in the Fourth Circuit, and then most recently in the 11th Circuit, that talks about, can agents serve on a filter team? Can AUSAs who aren't working on that case but are in the same office as the prosecuting office, can they serve on filter teams? And so there's a developing body of case law out there where, I think where it's going is certainly the government can seize, but they better go before a judge in a contested environment and work out a filter strategy before they start looking, particularly, if the information was seized from a law office or is known to have, potentially privileged information on it.
So, Claire, Charlie referred to some new case law. Can you tell us a little bit about that and whether that has changed the way you approach things from a strategy and tactical point of view as a defense lawyer?
I think that the courts have become a little bit more skeptical about taint teams over the last couple of years. And many of you remember Michael Cohen's case, when all of a sudden a special master was appointed to review his discovery, and then essentially in the Rudy Giuliani's matter, the government recommended a special master, which, if you think about that, that's pretty unusual, right? But that's because of the precedent set in the Cohen case. But essentially what's happened now is, for example, the Fourth Circuit, and the case is called In Re Search Warrant Issued 6/13/19, but it's 942 Fed 3rd 159. And if you haven't read this case, you need to read it, because it really puts taint teams in a different light. Essentially, it was involving a Baltimore law firm, and there was a search warrant, and they immediately, said, you're searching privileged material, to stop. And unbeknownst at the time, the magistrate judge had issued, not only when approved the search warrant, but also approved a filter protocol at the time. And so, essentially the filter protocol allowed the filter team that was from an adjacent district, not a different district, to review the material for privilege and then take that privilege material or the non-privilege and immediately send it to the investigative team. And so it went through a series, obviously, and it got to the Fourth Circuit. And the Fourth Circuit, of course, said, no, we can't have this. And essentially, there was some really significant, first of all, they said that the magistrate judge had deferred judicial function to the executive branch, meaning that they were making the full determinations of what was attorney-client privilege and what wasn't. So that's really, to me, that's the most important part, because that's where we get the judges involved, right? We get a special master involved in making these determinations. They also said that there was an appearance of unfairness because the taint team came from the same district but a different division. And then they also, you know, said that there was nobody there. The judges weren't making the determination about what was going to be considered privileged and what wasn't. And so, but the interesting part is what they did was they modified the protocol and sent it back. So essentially what happened was the plaintiff, in this case, the law firm, was given all of the documents back, and they had to review everything for privilege, put together a privilege log, and then you would go from there. If you couldn't come to an agreement, then of course you go to the judge or a special master. But it showed the skepticism of the court. Now, last month, at the end of August, in U.S. versus Corf, there was sort of a pulling back a little bit. And I would say it's more of a factual issue, because essentially in this case it was a series of companies and there was in-house counsel. And I think one of the things that's really a key issue here is there are law firms or there are attorneys who are definitively involved, but I think we can use that because the majority of our clients, right, there's attorney-client privilege material in their data. So I think we can use these on all of our cases. But essentially the court, in this case, once again, the magistrate judge had a filter protocol that was issued at the time of the search warrant, but what was different was that there was actually a standard for review, which made it a little bit different. But you know, the court decided it wasn't per se inappropriate for the government to look at the documents. But once again, they said the filter team could review them, but once they determined what was non-privileged, they all had to go to the plaintiff to review. So I would say, I recently am in some significant litigation regarding a filter protocol that was breached by the government. And unfortunately, I can't talk about details because it's sealed. But when you're making determinations or if you're negotiating your filter protocols with the government, I would say look very closely at these cases and be incredibly detailed. Because the government, let's face it, they're not used to doing this. They're not used to being a little bit more restrained. And so they're making errors. And those errors can certainly inure to your client. So, but the law is changing, and I think if you look at these cases, it can really help structure your arguments. And quite frankly, I'll be really curious to see what the judge does and does the government breach the filter protocol.
So the government did not seek cert on that Fourth Circuit case, which really, at least in the Fourth Circuit, turned their world upside down considerably. My view is because it was a bad case for them to take up because it was a law firm that had their data taken. But anybody in the panel want to venture any guesses on how long it takes for the taint team, filter team issue to get to the Supreme Court and how the Supreme Court would feel about taint teams and filter teams? Open mic.
I hope my case does. Because I don't know. I mean, I think we have a good record. It's going to get there. Because I think there's too many issues that are outstanding that, you know, the higher court needs to rule on, especially regarding privilege. And I do think the court has always recognized that attorney-client privilege is sacred, and I think they'll be very judicious about what they determine.
I think the practice pointer on the defense side is stick up for your client. So if you see, you know, if you're concerned that privileged information, potentially protected information, has been seized, then, you know, go to the court early and raise the issue. And so in both of these cases, the posture is on an injunction. So the defense moves for a preliminary injunction to halt the government from reviewing the information until there is an appropriate filter strategy in place. And so that's how it got to the Fourth Circuit and the Eleventh Circuit, was an appeal from from a denial or grant of a preliminary injunction. So I do think there's room to litigate on behalf of a defendant to really do clients some good by sticking up loud at the very beginning of the case.
And I'll also say that in some other matters recently that I've had is the department, including Maine Justice, is well aware of the Fourth Circuit case and are being very careful about how they move forward. And that's all pretty much all I can say at this point, but I think that it's having its effect, which I think is, once again, it's an opportunity for the defense to litigate this.
So I want to come back to what you would do if you employ this aggressive strategy, get an injunction, and the court says, congratulations, the data is all yours now. But let me start with a question for Erin. I think after attending this very conference several years ago, I got a call from a sole practitioner in a case who had just received 1 million electronic documents a few weeks before trial and said, what do I do? And I didn't know at the time what to tell him. It's one of the saddest calls I've ever gotten. I didn't have 25 lawyers to spare, and he clearly wasn't tech savvy enough to figure out a technology solution, nor was I. But Erin is tech savvy and works in a federal defender's office, and she has what I hope is some good news for us, that there may be some strategies for those defendants who may not have all the resources of the Fortune 500 companies that we heard today about how to deal with a data dump.
Yeah, so I'm going to be realistic. It is overwhelming. Even if you have the resources, you as the attorney need to know what's in there. And so it's okay to accept the fact that it's overwhelming, but at the same time, it's liberating that we're in this space of electronic discovery, because you're not going to be locked in a storage room with boxes of paper. You are actually able to walk around with 2 terabytes in your pocket and be able to actually analyze discovery on the go. But I think we start early on in the case, and I think right before the pandemic, at the end of 2019, the federal rules were amended. And this rule has gotten missed by almost every practitioner I've spoken to, maybe because of the pandemic. But 16.1 is a rule that was in effect in December of 2019. And in that rule, it specifically requires that you and the government meet and confer to discuss how discovery will be handled within 14 days of arraignment. And then after that meeting, you actually have, in that rule, the right to go to the court if there are any issues that arise, and then a court can intervene. And the last thing prosecutors want, from my experience, is having the court intervene in discovery matters. And I know our judges, for the most part, don't like to intervene in discovery matters, but now you actually have some teeth. You have a rule that you can go back to and say, hey, you're required to meet with me, and we're required to talk about this. At the same time, though, you kind of have to have some knowledge as to how you want to receive that discovery. I find that it's helpful, and I've had a case with 1 million documents that went to trial, unfortunately, before December 2019. But we found it very helpful when you're meeting with the government and building that rapport over the period of your case. Ask them what the hot docs are, or the key docs are, those key documents, because you can build your search terms and your search platform based on those documents. Because now you know, okay, the government's highlighting these for a reason, and then you can start to build your searches from there. On top of that, I also found that it was very helpful to ask the government to bait stamp their documents. And if they don't bait stamp their documents that are given to you, or anything that's given to you, it's really difficult for you to keep track of what you received and what you're missing. And in the middle of trial, we had the government pull out a document. You're like, whoa, what's the base number on that? Thank you, and then we can pull it up ourselves in our own database. And so those are things that I found really helpful and really crucial, because when you're in trial, you don't have, you know, your huge batch of resources there at the counsel table with you. You need to have a method in which you can address and search for this stuff on the fly in the middle of trial. Now, granted, trials are maybe a dime a dozen now, but at the same time, you need to be cognizant of the fact that you might have to be able to access this material on the fly in the middle of trial. PDFs. I don't know how many of you receive your documents in PDF format. If you're not familiar with PDFs and how they work, I think that is definitely an area you might want to look at some training. And for those of you who are on who take CJA cases, please understand, just because you're a part of a firm, please take advantage of the resources Defender Services has, because we actually have trainings on electronic discovery, how to manage it, and we teach, I have taught at these trainings, and I'm very, very shocked to see how few attorneys actually attend these trainings. In order for us to become effective, it is incumbent upon us to know what kind of data is out there and what we should be looking for. So I really encourage you to reach out to Defender Services, look at fd.org for training opportunities, because that will open your minds to what's really out there. And just real briefly, because I can go on forever and I don't want to go over your heads, because when I start talking about technology, it gets real, real crazy. But just for example, if you get dumped a bunch of PDF documents, understand that a PDF is a snapshot of an actual native file, like a Word document, an Excel form, or an email. If you identify something in that PDF doc pile that you think is really important, ask for the native file. If you're not getting your stuff in Eclipse or another database, ask for the native file. Because in that Word document, you'll find metadata that tells you who is the author of that document. It might have been found in your client's computer, but a co-defendant might have actually authored it. And so that creates a lot of interesting issues for cross-examination. Ask for the native Excel spreadsheet. You can manipulate that data. But make sure you save a separate copy of it, because once you manipulate it, you're going to mess up the whole original. So don't do that. Save a separate one. But ask for the native files. And if you want to talk to me more about native files, come find me. I'm happy to talk to you about it, because in the middle of trial, we actually cross-examined a co-defendant. When we pulled up his Word document, we're like, wait a minute, you said X, Y, and Z, but as a matter of fact, you created it on this date, and this is your name. And we had a judge that allowed us to create snapshots of that metadata and create exhibits from that on the fly in court. So you're missing out on a lot if you're just relying on PDF files. Hey. So those are things, even if you've got a million resources, if you don't understand what you're looking at, you're going to be missing out on a lot of data.
Hey, Erin, this is great. Can you give us just a few examples, or as many examples as you want? You're the MVP of this panel here. Can you explain what metadata is and give a few examples of things that may not occur to us that we can find out in metadata?
Yes. Yeah, so metadata is a variety of things. So, for example, in a Word document, when you go to the file menu, you go to properties, the information in that little box is metadata. It has where it came from, when it was modified and created. Now, if you get cell phone data, the location data, if you receive a Cellebrite report or a UFED reader, you want the actual real report, you can actually filter out metadata in those text messages and pictures, and you can find the location data for those pictures, apps that were activated at the time. So location data, authoring, when a file was created, when it was modified, those are examples of metadata. So anything you want to know about a document or the original document, that's where you will find it.
And another definitional question. Some of us are old enough to remember when I was a paralegal back in the early 80s, a bait stamp where I actually hand stamped the document, and then I would turn to the next page and I would stamp it, and the number would change. What's a bait stamp look like on a electronic document?
It looks exactly the same. It's much easier for them to do, because you actually have programs that automatically number the baits numbers on the document. So it looks exactly the same, and it becomes searchable because it's text within that document, and so you can actually search based on the bait stamp. And many times when they produce that discovery, they'll give you the batch with the bait stamps on there, so you can keep track of where you are in the process. So it looks exactly the same, but now it's searchable because it's a digital text on that document.
Two more questions for you. One is native files. I'm always concerned that my opponent, either in a civil case or a criminal case, may have manipulated a native file. How can I tell that that's not the case? And how does my opponent know that when you get this dream native file that you want, that you have not manipulated it?
Well, the beauty of it getting it from the government, you can say, well, this is what you gave me, government. And so it's hard to know. It does require you having a conversation with your client. But when you receive the batches from the government, you have to assume that it was captured in, at that time when they created the image of the computer. And so you should be able to see if it was manipulated once you go back to the properties of that native file to see if it was actually modified after they did the search of that device. For cell phones, it's really tricky because every time they do a Cellebrite run on a cell phone, the hex data on that changes every time. So the data on the phone actually changes slightly every time. And if you don't have an expert who knows how to read those hash values and hex data, it'll be really hard to determine if anything was truly manipulated. But for the most part, you'll get the real capture at the time they did the original search.
Okay, I'm sorry, you put some new terms in there I've got to ask you about. Cellebrite, what's Cellebrite?
What's
hex data and what's a hash? Is it a hashtag?
Hash value. So Cellebrite is a tool that is used by law enforcement that is, it's a little portable device that they can plug into your phone, into any sort of mobile device, a tablet, and I'm gonna throw this out there, drones are now part of discovery now, because in people are using their phones to control drones, and that data is now on your cell phone. They plug it into your device, and if it's unlocked or if they have a way to break into your phone, that's where you get that phone forensic data that's produced in discovery. And you see, if you get a UFED report, it's those funky little reports that have links to emails and text messages and apps and whatnot. But Cellebrite is the tool that law enforcement generally uses to pull and extract data from any sort of mobile device, phone, tablet, drone.
Cellebrite is also private vendors now use Cellebrite. Yes. So if you have your own client's cell phone that you're downloading, you will get a Cellebrite. Most of the time, your vendor will have the report in Cellebrite. So the private sector now has them too.
And if you're lucky enough, my office, we have our own Cellebrite device. Not very many defender offices do, but if you're in a district where a defender office does have a Cellebrite device and they have an actual certified analyzer, I'm a certified analyzer, my IT professional in my office is a certified analyzer, we can actually help you walk you through analyzing your client's phone. So just keep an eye out for that. It's not just law enforcement who has these tools now, we have them too.
So last question for you, Erin, and then I'll let you off the hook here a little bit. Let's say I'm a CJA lawyer, sole practitioner over 50, and I have a little downtime, and I want to be able to talk like you talk. Where would you recommend I go to start that process?
It's called a PhD program.
Let's face it, in order for us to be effective in representing our clients, no matter if you're in a defender office, a large firm, solo, you need to know what is out there. Like I said, Defender Services offers free trainings on these things to anyone who accepts CJA cases. I wouldn't trust YouTube all the time, but YouTube can be really helpful. But at the same time, if you are just at a point where you're just incredibly overwhelmed, ask the court for help. There are funds available for you to ask for a paralegal, not just an expert. So don't forget you have those resources available to you, and contact your local defender office. We are more than happy to help you, because we want to see you succeed, because the more you guys succeed, the better our jobs become and it forces the judges to make better decisions. So Defender Services, FD.org, look at training, free for CJA panel members. Ask the court for funds to get an expert or a paralegal or an investigator who loves doing this sort of thing. And ask for help from us. We're free, happy to help.
also want to put a plug in that, you know, many of us rely on our paralegals and others to do all this work for us, but I will say there is a lot of value in learning how to do this yourself. And it's not that difficult, but you all need to be able to use relativity and tools and be able to search some of these things yourself, because when you're doing that prep at 11 o'clock at night, and your paralegal may not be there, and you've got to find that document, or something's going on, that you could be able to do it yourself. And what I've seen is a lot of people say, I don't want to do that, and then you get stuck. And so, as much as we all don't like to sometimes learn new things, I think these days it's incumbent upon all of us to have some rudimentary knowledge of how to do this.
And you don't know what questions to ask or what to have people look for, and unless you understand it yourself. So let me shift gears here a little bit. I'm sure everybody in this room has gotten a subpoena or a CID that has a three-page schedule of technical, what appears to be technical nonsense attached to it about all the requirements that the government is imposing on your client, which may be a small or mid-sized business, in order to the way they want the data produced. And my question for you is for Charlie. How, why is that all on there, and have you had any success pushing back on that since you've been in private practice? What's the government perspective, and what's your perspective as a private lawyer when you receive that?
Yeah. So the government's perspective is really, you know, very similar to the defense, in that they want the information in a format that they can quickly process, search, manipulate, mine, whatever, the data. And so it kind of gets back to the comment that I made earlier about more technical resources being available in district. So every district has, you know, a lit support team that will get the data, and then they will be able to use relativity or Eclipse or whatever, and they want it in a format where they can receive it and can quickly load it and then process it through that format. So that's the reason why it's asked for. That way there is no, 100% uniform software platforms that U.S. Attorney's offices use. Some use, you know, different processing software than others. But typically that whatever district is asking for the information, they're gonna put the protocols on there that will be most helpful to them. Now, and that has been very eye-opening for me in the last few months, being on the defense side now, is just how overwhelming that can be to receive not just the subpoena and the breadth of the subpoena, the information that's called for, but also the technical requirements that are included. And so, you know, I think that typically the government is open to a conversation about it. So if you get a subpoena and it calls for, you know, technical data in format ABC, but your vendor or your company or your IT, the IT support service of the company that you're representing says, hey, we can do it in DEF, then pick up the phone and call. In my experience, you know, those issues can be worked through. Everyone is kind of on the same page in that they want the data in a format that can be accessible, you know, for both sides. So that's my experience, is to reach out and to call. Be interested to know if you all have different perspectives on that.
Well, I've never seen the government not accept material. Right? I mean, I just know right now there's a witness in a case that I have about a subpoena, and the person has really no means, and just said, literally, I'm going to take my box of stuff, and I'm going to go down to the grand jury on the day that they tell me that I'm supposed to bring it, and I'm going to bring it. And, you know, we were sort of like, canned advice, you know, whatever. And he called us later, and he goes, I got there, and I sat there for 20 minutes, and finally somebody showed up just sort of out of happenstance. I gave them the box, and they took it. So, I they make these requirements, and, many of us are able to satisfy them, right? And our clients have the means to do it. But I do think that, as Troy said, that, you know, you can negotiate with the government. You know, some of our clients can't afford some of the stuff. And, you know, some of the outrageous demands that are being made in these subpoenas are extremely expensive. So, I do think, they'll take what you can.
So, Claire, other than being a bystander to this paper production, when's the last time you made a production of hard copy documents to the government in response to a subpoena?
Last month.
Oh, okay.
Last month.
Oh, okay, yeah, but that, actually, that, so that was a distinction I should have made. But you actually had them scanned. They went to the government electronically, even though you, somebody has
right.
the paper copy
no,
still.
No, I did not give them the original.
And the paper may be relevant for some reason, you know, if there's some sort of handwriting analysis, although I've found that that's a bit of a dying art. Question document examination of handwritten notes doesn't happen so much anymore.
Especially when you have DocuSign now.
Right.
I was looking at a contract the other day, and I was like, wow, somebody says the person didn't sign it, you have to go back to DocuSign and get them to verify.
Right, right. The modern equivalent is somebody who looks at the metadata like Erin does and looks for anomalies, right? Yeah, okay. So, well, let me ask you this. Does anybody think, so I get annoyed as could be when I get those subpoenas because I sort of say, how dare they tell me exactly how this has to be produced. But the more I think about it, I think about the back end and how important it is that if we do receive that data dump, which we're going to get in most big white-collar cases today, that it be organized and searchable in a good way. Maybe a little lightning round here. What do people think about whether we're headed towards standardization of how data is produced? And if not, is there something the bar can do about that, the defense and the prosecutors working together? Erin, you have thoughts?
Yeah, I think it starts from everyone meeting at the table and having a conversation. I don't think you're gonna have nationwide standards. I think that's gonna be very difficult to achieve in the short term, perhaps in the long term. But I do think, at least within your district, my district has always been very tech forward. Like, we have paperless trials. And so we've kind of gotten to a point where there's an understanding between all of us that we should receive our discovery this way because it allows our jobs to move a lot faster. It makes us more efficient. So I do think it requires just meeting at the table. Like, look, they drive us crazy, I get it. But at the end of the day, you know, it really does make a huge difference when you can at least get on the same page about something. And if it's discovery, let it be that. So that's where I think we should start.
Well, those of us who live in the South and are dealing with, you know, SBI and GBI and local law enforcement, they don't have the resources to standardize anything. And I don't foresee that, at least, you know, in North Carolina, we don't even have electronic filing in state court. So I just can't see standardization of some of the discovery, but I think with government, we'll be able to get that to that point. But I think, remember, they're dealing with all these other agencies who don't have the means and, quite frankly, don't really care. They'll just say, you get what we give you. So I think it's a long time coming.
Yeah, that's the challenge, because from the U.S. Attorney's Office perspective, you might deal, you know, some of the components that the prosecutors deal with are DOJ components like FBI, ATF, DEA, but they're also dealing with IRS. That's not a DOJ component. So they're going to have their own software, or some of the state agencies like the, you know, the GBI, the Georgia Bureau of Investigation, they're going to have their own tools. And so that really makes it difficult to have a uniform standard for all electronic discovery, but I think it has to happen. What I'm hopeful for is that it happens on the reader side. In other words, maybe not everybody uses the same technology for their body camera, for example. But there's a universal reader that can process lots of different platforms. That's my hope. I think that is probably, to be optimistic, the quickest way to solve that problem.
Hey, Charlie, you mentioned body cameras. Has there been any new developments on the federal side with respect to body cameras? There's been a lot of work. The APA has done a lot of work on when local law enforcement should be wearing body cameras and how the data collected should be used. Anything happening on the federal front? Any developments?
New announcement out of the DOJ in the last week that ATF is going to be the first federal agency that's going to have a body-worn camera policy. And so looks like they are going to be outfitted with body cam and then required to use it during pre-planned operations. And so that's interesting to me because in the last several years, that has not always been the focus at the federal level. But I think what really drove it in part is because a lot of the state and local law enforcement do have body camera policies, those are the same officers who were serving as federal task force officers. And so there was this rub. The local agency was saying, you got to wear your body cam and you got to turn it on. And the federal was saying, we don't have a body cam policy. And so I think that that is probably, I think you'll see more federal agencies with body cam policies, not less.
Don't forget to get the audit logs for those body worn cameras. So much information's in there, including when they turn it off manually and turn it back on. So make sure you ask for those audit logs for your body worn cameras.
And is that, that's an electronic document, electronically generated?
Yes, it's usually an Excel spreadsheet or something like that. Okay.
So let me shift gears now to something we talk about a lot, which is Brady. And we've talked about number of panels a day, how much data there is. And Charlie, you just left the U.S. Attorney's Office for the Middle District of Georgia. How in the world is a prosecutor supposed to determine what is Brady and what is not in a million electronic documents?
It's a challenge, for sure, on a couple fronts. One is because there's so much data, how is someone going to get through it and make that analysis? And then two, depending on the stage of the case, the prosecutor may not fully appreciate what the defenses are. And so it becomes, that's certainly an integral part in a Brady analysis. So, my experience is that the vast majority, the overwhelming majority of prosecutors want to do the right thing to comply with Brady obligations. And so now you've got the Due Process Protection Act, which has just come out, which requires the judge to include in an order informing the government of its Brady obligations, so that to the extent that there was some prosecutor out there who didn't take that obligation seriously, that is going to go away. So it's a big deal, and it just requires an incredible amount of effort on the part of prosecutors. It means that fewer cases are going to be brought in prosecutors' offices, assuming resources stay the same, but it's certainly one that everyone has to address.
So, Claire, Charlie mentioned the Due Process Protection Act of 2020, which now requires an order to be issued in every case, reminding and I think ordering compliance with Brady. What is your view of a prosecutor's obligation pre-trial to produce Brady? How do you define Brady in the pre-trial context?
Well, there's what we think it is, that it's anything that's exculpatory, right? But if you go back to Bagley, it's anything that's materially, that reasonably would lead to either acquittal or, I actually went back to the case last night, reasonable probability that the evidence would result in a different result. I mean, so it's exculpatory evidence, and I think about, and I think many of us, write these letters to the government, requesting Brady material, and I think, and Rob and I were talking about this, we're getting more and more specific about what we're asking for, during witness prep, people who say something different that's in the 302, if you have a defense that the government is not aware of, and you think there might be something exculpatory out there, because let's face it, they don't know our defenses. Remember, that's the one thing we have that's in our back pocket, is that the government doesn't know what our defense is. And, if we think there's something out there that's going to help them, we're going to have to give them a peek into that window so that they can. And then when the issue happens later and we find out they didn't produce it or whatever happens, they deep sixed it or whatever, then we're in a better place. But, Brady is such a difficult thing. I realize, and I've never been a prosecutor, but I have to put myself in their shoes, and I'm like, well, they wouldn't have known that was important, right? And so it's up to us to give them some idea of what's out there so that they might be able to find it, or they haven't, they didn't think it was relevant, right? So
Erin, some prosecutors and some defense lawyers and some judges will differentiate between Brady information and Giglio information, as if they're two separate piles of information. How do you, is that a distinction that matters, and how do you view that, and how do you address that as a defense lawyer?
Well, one, I don't see a distinction. I can't say that the prosecutors have that same perspective. thankfully, and I think, you know, you guys should definitely check your local orders or discovery orders, our district does not differentiate between the two. And so, thankfully, you know, when we make our requests, we can always refer back to our standard discovery order and say, hey, this covers everything. And, if there's impeachment evidence in, that you have, you met with your witness and their statement is now inconsistent with the 302 that you've given us, you need to produce that information, even if it's not reduced to a writing. And I start putting that in there because they have a habit of saying, well, my agent didn't take any notes. I was like, but they have ears and they have eyes. And so you know what your witness said, and you can put that in an email. So be really, and there are certain prosecutors that I deal with that have a habit of behaving that way. And so I start adding in my request, even if it's not reduced to a writing, I need to know if this occurred or if you have any information that will fall under Brady or Giglio. But thankfully we have a standard order we can refer back to, but again, like I said, our prosecutors still interpret it a little differently.
So there's not a lot of case law on the point you make, but it's a good one, and I always go to pains to describe Brady and Giglio information, not material, because it's the information we've all watched FBI agents take notes and witness interviews, and they don't write down every word, and they can't write down every word, right? There's been some trend, or there was a pilot program in DOJ to start tape recording certain witness interviews. Have any of you seen the fruits of that, or had that come up in any of your cases, in any federal cases? Not yet.
Certainly custodial interviews, yes, but I have it in non-custodials.
Can I just say something also about when you write those letters to the prosecutors requesting Brady, and I don't know, I'm curious if any of you get this. We get these letters back that are unbelievable. They're like, so-and-so says such-and-such. So-and-so, like the witnesses, they'll just write out what the contradictory statement is, and in this long letter with all these various witnesses. I'm just curious, anybody else get that?
Anybody have perspective on that?
Yeah, but do they respond to your request? I mean, that's what we get, which is actually, believe it or not, incredibly helpful, right? Because it's great impeachment material. It's like, you know, this is what the report says, and now they're saying X. And, I was shocked. I've gotten those twice now.
So let me ask you this, Claire. How do you cross-examine the witness with a letter from a prosecutor, though?
I'm assuming so. When you went in, for the second interview, and you know, you told them the following, right? Are you aware that when they wrote this down, they're like, "Oh, either I did say it at the time, or I didn't say it at the time."
Right.
I mean, it's it's all the kinds of things the judges won't let you put it in evidence, right? But you get around it any way you can. But anything that's contradictory, a witness says is helpful.
Yeah. So let me ask you this. So we have the new rule that requires production of Brady and Giglio information, and then we still have the Jinx Act, which seems to give prosecutors cover and defense lawyers for reverse jinx, cover to wait until after the witness has stepped off the stand in order to, but before the statements have to be produced. And some judges will say, I'm really powerless to do anything about it, but maybe they'll warn before trial, I'm going to grant a continuance if you don't give it early. But how has that played out in your districts and in terms of the timing of Giglio information? Or do you find the prosecutors are saying, well, you don't get that till later because it's a verbatim statement covered by the Jinx Act, and we're not going to give it to you till much later?
Sometimes if I remember, I try to put on the record, hey, judge, we'll like early disclosure of Jinx, and then have the judge encourage them to produce it. And then usually when the judge is encouraging the government to do something, they kind of take that hint and then produce early. But again, they always have that caveat, well, he's not really obligated to, but it'd be really great if you could do that so we don't have to get paused in the middle of trial.
I think most of the districts that I've had matters in, Jinx is usually provided either 10 time I've seen that you don't get them until the end is when there's a safety issue. And, you know, the government feels that, that you know, there's a good basis for that, and the judges certainly allow it. But I've just found that the, you know, the government just wants to move things along, and you get it. You don't get it when you, you know, early on, but you do get it, you know, some time to review.
Yeah, that's my, my pre-prosecution defense days was, you know, it might be at the end of the day, hey, here our government says, hey, here are our witnesses for tomorrow, here's James. You know, hopefully before then, but I've had that occur.
So, Erin, you said something interesting early on about how you ask the prosecutors to identify their hot documents. Has that been generally successful for you, and number one? And number two, do you think that the government has an obligation to identify Brady information, however you define it, and to pull that out of their pile of a million documents and label it for you?
Regarding the hot docs, I have found that to be really successful, and that 9 out of 10 prosecutors would sit down with us and go through the hot docs. Because a lot, honestly, is like, look, if you want us to try to resolve this case, or you want my client to accept this plea agreement, then you need to give me something that I can show this client and to say, hey, this is a really good deal because here's the evidence they have against you, and here are really bad documents that show X, Y, and Z. Regarding Brady, I think once you pull that trigger and say, hey, I'm seeking this specific Brady evidence, I think that at that point they're obligated to seek it out and provide it. I don't think they get to just sit on it. I've had one prosecutor literally beginning of this week or the end of last week say, hey, I'm sorry, I just don't have it. And I was like, but in your last 7 emails to me since April, you said you had all of these documents and you had these agents seek out these documents, and all of a sudden now you're saying, oh, I just don't have it. I think that was his way of trying to avoid his obligation to turn over potentially, but I'm pretty sure it's Brady information. And then, you know, but then you're not the average prosecutor, but then you say, well, you're saying you may not have it in your hands, but your agents have it, so you're obligated to turn it over. You're still, it's not because it's not in your hands in your office, your agents have it, you're obligated to turn it over. You said you have it, you have an Excel spreadsheet that is based off of these documents that you claim you don't have. Now I know that you have it, turn it over. And I've always had that position that they are obligated to turn it over. If they're doing their job well, if they're being ethical prosecutors, then they should feel they're obligated to turn that over. That's my position. They disagree, but it's okay. We keep them.
Well, so is it your position that they have to turn it, can it be turned over as document number 972,421? Out of a million documents, or does it need to be handed to you on a silver platter?
I mean, they can identify an area within the discovery where it's located. They may not know what the exact Bates number, but they know it's in there. And they cannot intentionally bury it, because that's not ethical at the end of the day. Because you're essentially trying to convict a potentially innocent person. That's unethical. And so when you, that line, when they start getting really close to that line, then you call them out and saying, hey, I'm asking for this information. You are obligated, not under the Constitution, but under even our own orders, to provide it. Please identify what those records are. And so burying it is essentially the same as hiding it. And so I don't see, you know, they're not fulfilling their obligations under Brady at that point.
So Claire or Charlie, what's the case law tell us about that, if we're going to go litigate that issue?
You go first.
Well, there's nothing that requires the government to go out and find it in the material that they gave you. I've had that thrown in my face numerous times, unless I'm missing something recently. You know, the last 2 matters I've had with a huge amount of discovery, I found the Brady probably at the 11th hour, but, you know, I found it, so that claim goes out the window. I have brought it at the very end to one judge, and he said, have it now, so what's the problem? It's an issue. I don't, you know, if the prosecutors know they have it, they have to turn it over, but, you know, otherwise us, say, you have everything, my favorite is you have everything we have. I was like, okay, great. Oh,
my God. Charlie, what's a careful prosecutor to do, one that is ethical, trying to do the right thing, but also knows that Claire may have defenses in her head that has not occurred to the prosecutor yet? How does the ethical prosecutor handle that in this world of immense quantities of immense electronic data?
I think that the best prosecutors that I've seen do exactly what Erin said, and that is that they're more than welcome, I mean, more than happy to identify the hot docs, to provide them to the defense. And if there is plainly Brady exculpatory material to, upon request, bring that to the defense's attention as well, with the primary goal being that's what's going to resolve the case. And so if the defendant understands the pros and the cons of the case, that's when plea negotiations get real and when a deal can hopefully be done. So, I mean, I think, again, that the best prosecutors that I've seen are quick, to do that. The other thing is no prosecutor wants to go to the judge and say, it's in the documents. A lot of it kind of depends on the record that the defense counsel has laid. If the defense counsel has written the prosecutor and said, I'm looking for this, and doesn't get a response or explains why, hey, listen, you provided all these documents, only half of them are able to be searched with my Adobe Reader. Can you provide them in a format to where my Adobe Reader can search the other half? I mean, it really requires some advocacy on the part of the defense counsel to posture the case to where if they do have to go before the judge on a Brady issue, that case can be made. And you have an excellent example of how that has recently come up with a pro se defendant.
I'm trying to remember what it is, but okay. So So I'll ask you.
Prompting the moderator.
Yeah. So let me ask whoever wants to take this. So, are there some cases in recent, some of which have gotten a lot of attention of Brady failures recently, and I don't know who wants to take this, but one case that comes to mind that I read about just the headlines was the Michael Avenatti case. Anyone want to take it?
I still don't understand 100% of what happened. He requested metadata in some of his accounting records, and apparently the taint team never looked at it, and during trial it came up. I guess it came up during his cross-examination, and that's when the judge stopped the trial, realized he had asked for it, and he was smart. He asked for it in advance, before the trial started, I believe, and I think that's what happened.
Yeah, so you're right. Give the devil his due. He asked for it. He made a specific request for it, and lo and behold, they didn't give it to him. And it folds back into what we were talking about earlier with taint teams too. And apparently, it was a miscommunication between the taint team and the team actually prosecuting the case. And lo and behold, he gets a pro se defendant gets a. And when you said you have an excellent example, I thought it was one of my cases, and I don't represent Michael Avenatti, nor was I his standby counsel, so that's what threw me off. But it's just an amazing example, right, of just what we're talking about, and I guess he has a retrial in October, but he still has to report to prison for his East Coast conviction in before that. So,
he's certainly not out of the woods. His legal troubles.
It actually raises one issue, and then I'll wrap up with a few things here, which is, Erin, how do you deal with electronic discovery with incarcerated individuals who say, boy, I sure would like to see that discovery, and it's my life on the line here, shouldn't I get to see it?
We show it to them. I mean, myself and my paralegal, we take our laptops down to the jail. We have actually Bluetooth, wireless Bluetooth headphones that we can give to them so they can hear. We can't do contact visits right now because COVID is rampant at our jail, and allow them to listen to it. For those who, and 9 times out of 10, they'd be like, oh, okay, wait a minute, that's my confession coming up, never mind, I'm good. and then and then other times, you know, and our clients have been really understanding with the pandemic. I will do a summary, I'll do an outline, break down their criminal history and kind of some of the highlights of some of the discovery, and they appreciate that too. So you do have that as a backup. But we show it to them. I mean, I would think, you know, you can always say, well, we're not obligated to show them everything, but I think in order for them to feel like they're invested in their case, you know, you at least show them something. Like, you can say, look, we have all these videos, but here are the ones we think are the ones you really need to see. And that goes a long way in the client management aspect of things. But we take our laptops or our tablets. And
the government doesn't have any issue with you taking electronics into the jail or taking the documents in the jail, the institution doesn't have a problem with you bringing electronics in?
No, they have come a long way. It took from some of our smaller counties, a little challenging at first, but they have begun to work with us because they want those federal dollars. So, we haven't had any issues with doing that. I mean, they'll search us and everything, but outside of that, it's pretty cool.
So to go back to the question I asked Claire a while back about how do you define Brady, how do you define exculpatory information in a pretrial context? The Justice Manual was amended over 10 years ago to say that it is Justice Department policy that all favorable information is going to be produced to the defense, not just that which is technically Brady, which might be Brady on appeal. And my question for everybody in the panel is, and you may have different perspectives on that, is how do you feel as though that's gone? And are there any other examples of recent Brady failures that come to mind where that, either through inadvertence or sloppiness or for some other reason, wasn't abided by? Erin, do you have a perspective on how whether the government's doing what the Justice Manual says they're supposed to be doing as a general matter, at least in your district?
Yeah, I think, and I know I sound a little harsh at times. It's really just like two prosecutors I'm having these issues with. it's just two. But I do think they are really trying to do the right thing in the majority of the cases. I think we're all trying to do the right thing. And I think I have not, I do believe that we're all trying to have, you know, meet at a common goal, and I don't foresee any sort of conflict regarding trying to find Brady. Now, whether or not they're sloppy, there are sloppy prosecutors. There's sloppy defense attorneys, too. I mean, I think we have to take responsibility for being sloppy sometimes and not knowing what's in our, not knowing our case well enough. I mean, there's some defense attorneys who have to accept, just be honest about that. But I do think, again, you meet at the table, you attempt to come to some common ground, and that's really where you get the most bang for your buck.
Well, I mean, I do think that the majority of the prosecutors are just like we are, trying to do the best we can. But, you know, every so often, you know, you see these cases that just, you know, are really disturbing. And there's that case from New York. Prosecutors brought out during trial, you know, an exhibit that was never produced, and they, you know, eventually after the defendant was convicted, the government actually dismissed the case, and the judge decided to look into it further. And after getting the emails and the text messages, you know, there was an actual, you know, intent to hide this from the defense counsel. It was exculpatory. So, I mean, that case is rare. We don't see those very often, but, you know, unfortunately, they're out there, and we all have to be vigilant to keep an eye on them too.
Yeah, I do find, and just real quick, when a case is postured for trial, there is a shift in attitude in how the communications go, and they're not as forthcoming. And I do think you tend to get situations like in the middle of trial, there's a document or an exhibit pops up, and you're like, where did this come from? So I do think when you are preparing for trial, and a case is definitely going to trial, you do have to be a lot more diligent in making sure you make those requests and making sure that, and you do the open file review, you go to the U.S. Attorney's office and actually view what they have in their office to kind of avoid some of those things happening, saying, hey, I went and viewed your open file, and in court, you know, you now come up with this new exhibit we didn't see in your open file. do think we should definitely make sure you check the open file in the U.S. Attorney's Office prior to trial, so that way when it comes up in court, you can say, Judge, we went, we saw everything, this was not in there.
Let me just add from the prosecutor's perspective that, you know, certainly it was the policy of our office to provide, you know, all information, and my understanding is that that was really the policy of every office that I ever had any material contact with in the U.S. Attorney's Office for a couple reasons. One, you know, at the end of the day, an AUSA is there in the overwhelming majority because they want to serve the public and they want to do justice, and that's a part of doing justice. Number two, though, is because a Brady violation for a prosecutor is like the third rail. I mean, good luck ever coming back from that. So there is a real fear factor there as well, which is, you know, borne out in the New York case that that Claire mentioned. But and back to one of Aaron's earlier points, a great way to avoid being accused of a Brady violation is to base number all of your discovery that's produced, because then you got a record of that it was produced, and here's what it is.
So just to put a plug in for people in the defense, in your toolkit as a defense lawyer, the case in the Southern District of New York that Claire referred to was before Judge Allison Nathan. And what actually happened in that case is there was a document that the government realized it should have produced as Brady. It wasn't a huge data dump, but they put it in with a bunch of other documents, didn't explain the relevance to it. Very good defense team, wasn't able to react in time. And on post-trial motions, they were upset that it was handled the way it was. Judge Nathan got really interested in the issue, sort of conducted her own investigation. The government, very much to its credit, dismissed all charges, but the prosecutors are still being investigated in that case. So it's an interesting case where the Brady failure, actually the government did turn it over in the middle of trial. So what we often deal with the defense lawyers is the judge will say, well, you've got it now, what are you complaining about? And as a defense lawyer, I say, but I did what the judges told us to do earlier today, which is prepare, and I can't change my strategy necessarily on a dime based on a surprise that happens in the middle of trial. So I've got a couple of, just a few questions left, but any questions from the audience before I ask that? Okay, well let me close up with this. Two questions for you, and we'll do them both at the same time. Any predictions on how technology is gonna change the practice of law in the next 5 to 10 years, number one? And number two, if you could prescribe one reform proposal that would make our system work better, more efficiently, and with more justice in the area of discovery, what would it be? Charlie, I'll start with you.
Wow, those are tough. I do think that technology is gonna continue to develop. You know, like Erin said earlier, she's walking around with a hard drive that's a little bit bigger than, you know, a wallet, and it's got 2 terabytes of information on there. So I think it is gonna become easier for, my hope is that it will become easier for smaller shop practitioners to receive electronic discovery and to make meaningful use out of it. And I think the technology advances are gonna help that. The price of technology is coming down. The abilities and features in technology are increasing, and I'm hoping that that continues, and I have to believe that it will. As far as making our system more fair, it is eye-opening and eye-popping to me the amount of money that just a witness or a subject, not even a target, who receives a subpoena has to spend in order to comply with it, to go and collect documents from servers and email accounts that may be all over the country, and some of it's deleted and some of it's archived and some of it's been, you know, the format's been changed so that it can be more efficiently stored, and to collect all of that is expensive. And then you can't just throw it over the side to the government. Someone has to review it so that they know what is in the information, which is incredibly expensive. And then it goes to the government. So I don't know what the fix is, but that's a real live issue, not just for, certainly for small companies and individuals, but even for mid-sized and large companies. It's becoming a bigger and bigger part of the budget. So, you know, in the civil world, There's a cost shifting procedure for, you know, what I'll call hard to get ESI. And it takes into account the means of the parties, and it takes into account the amount in controversy. And so I don't know what it looks like, but something I think has to give on this expense of complying with subpoenas.
Claire?
If today I think it's something like 99.5% of all data is electronic, and maybe even more than that now. And it's pretty much, you know, it's everything that we do, from our dishwashers to our phones. What I'm hoping to see in the future is that the actual electronics are standardized. You know, we have Apple phones versus Android phones. We have Cellebrite reports versus other reports. And the problem that's out there is that in industry, right, they all have their own trademarks and their own ways of storing data. And very few of them match. And so my feeling is I'm hoping sometime in the future, when maybe all those trademarks leave, there'll be more standardization of data, which will make it less expensive if it's easier to get together and to collaborate and to review. It's sort of a pipe dream, I think, because, you know, industry has such a huge piece of this, the way that they keep their data, right? They all have their own systems and programs and things like that, and every day there are new ones. You know, we're talking about those apps and everything this morning. There are new apps all the time. My forensic examiner was telling me that he can't keep up with them all. You know, he and I were talking about Signal and all these other ones, and he's like, I had two on the list he'd never heard of, and I just went on the internet and found them. So, you know, to me, that's going to be the biggest issue that we're all going to have to face, because our clients are not going to be able to afford this. You know, one of my good friends in Charlotte said to me, you know, Claire, it's changing the face of white collar. You either have clients who are, you know, have a lot of money and can do it right, or if they're lucky and they're indigent and they have the resources of the defenders, but those people in the middle are not going to be able to hire somebody to adequately represent them. And that's pretty scary. And I think many of us have seen that, right? In some of the cases in the clients that we represent, they can't afford to do what's needed. And so I think, you know, my wish is that in the future that the technology will become more standardized overall, but that's not going to happen for a long time. Too sobering. Sorry.
Any reforms, or is that reform? Is that both technology and reform?
Both.
Yeah.
Both. I mean, really. I mean, it's, if we keep having all these different, you know, types of data out there, there's going to be never-ending costs.
And Erin, you get the last word.
I'm team Android, by the way. Sorry, I can't stand Apple products. But I do think, like, with the advances in technology, even what you would consider a small case is going to have voluminous discovery. We were just talking earlier about your smart TV, and I was just thinking, oh, wait, they've got smart refrigerators now. All of these things are capturing information about your life. I have muted my little Google Home speaker, because I'm like, this thing is listening. And so, you know, just be mindful that the more technology advances, the more data is being collected. Your car, Android Auto, that's a link between your phone and your car. I mean, your car is digitized. It is collecting so much data about your life. So all of these things are going to be discoverable and showing up in what you might even consider a small case. So just be mindful of that, and just, you know, start to educate yourselves on all of this technology. It's moving quickly. The law can't keep up, but we can do our best to try to keep up with it. With regards to reform, that is a tough question. I do think I would like to see the prosecutors not have so much control over when and how things are produced. I'd like for there to be rules in place to say, hey, in order for a case to be expeditious and efficient, things need to be produced at a specific timeline that we can all work with, and then the court can make adjustments, you know, based on particular cases. But your head's gonna explode with this technology. I mean, I think it's, like I said, drone technology. Like, they're gonna be doing searches with drones now. You wanna make, that data is out there, and that stuff you're gonna wanna start asking for. they're using robots, you know, there's AI that's out there. It is really overwhelming. And if you're not a geek, that's okay. You don't have to be to actually know what this stuff does and what it's about. But it's, you know, it's going to be interesting the next 5 to 10 years, because things are moving so rapidly. Are you really curious to see what happens? And when your clients come out of prison, if they're in prison in 5 years from now, they're not going to know how to live, because everything's different.
Okay, on those encouraging thoughts for a defense lawyer. good luck out there, and see you next year.